was amazed how quickly it gets dark out. Does this caught anybody else by, you know, like off guard? Like I'm never turning on my lights at the right time, and I always think it's like must be like 10 o'clock, but it's only really 7 o'clock in the evening because it's been dark for so long. Sometimes it feels that way, doesn't it? Life feels dark for so long. Well, I got some good news this morning, and I got a story worth telling, and it starts like this. The prophet Isaiah says, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy, and they rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest." Now, here's the good news. We don't have to wait for coronavirus to be over to do this. Isaiah spoke into a time that was maybe as dark or darker than we're in right now. But he sees a future where people will rejoice as though at the harvest. That's why we're here this morning, to look forward, to see the God that serves us with a plan that serves us as well. So will you stand and rejoice with us as if we were harvesting today? Let's stand and rejoice.
in this place this morning, Lord, that through the reading of your scripture and through the words that you've given Bill this morning, Lord, that you would touch us and change us and focus our hearts on your Son, Lord, and the hope and the promise that he has for us. We love you, and it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, WordServe. Great to see you all this morning. I hope you're having a great week. As we come into our worship service, we want to make you aware of a few things going on. First, if you came in, you probably know by now to go ahead and register your attendance. You can scan the QR code on the signs or go to the link and let us know that you're here and let us know who's worshiping with you if you're worshiping at home. And then also, there's an opportunity to submit prayer requests on that form, so go ahead and do that as well. I'm going to invite Barbara to come up. Barbara is our children's director, and she's got some announcements to make.
Thank you. Hi, WordServe. We have a couple of exciting things going on, one of which is in this box. And I know you haven't seen it before. That's okay. We've done something kind of like it in the past. We did Advent boxes where you did this as a family. This is like that because you'll do it as a family. So you will take home one of these boxes per family. And it's the 12 days of Christmas. So when does that start? You don't have to guess. It's December 14th. It's on the little tag inside. And you will open it up and it says start on December 14th. You will read the tag and then find the item. I can't juggle the microphone and the box, sorry. You'll find the matching item. So what if you can't come this week to get your box or next week and you want to join us virtually? That's okay. Miss Susan and I will be virtual and we will read these and find the matching item. And at home, you can find an item like ours. So join us if you can grab a box. That's awesome. If you're not able to, join us virtually, and that'll be fun. So the next thing, and these are upstairs. After all the announcements, Miss Erica and I will take all the kids upstairs, and you will get your boxes then. My next announcement is that you are invited to a birthday party. Whose birthday party? Jesus! Yes! Yes! On December 20th, here. We are going to do a joint birthday party with First Fulcher upstairs, and we're going to do basic fun birthday stuff, you know, cupcakes, fun games, activities, but we also want you to bring a present. Instead of bringing a present to Jesus, you're going to bring a present for somebody in need. So we're asking for gifts to the Pregnancy Help Center in Sealy. What she needs are wipes, baby lotion, baby wash, and diapers. The most needed diapers are newborn and size 3 and up. And anybody can bring gifts. So we'll be collecting gifts next week and on the 20th, the date of the birthday party. So I hope that you're all will come to that. That's going to be lots of fun. And right now, before we go up, Miss Erica has a few words for all of you.
Doing this too often. I don't like being up here, but I have notes today, so that's good. Today I'm going to talk about a tradition that we have here at WordServe. We are going on more than a decade of giving 100% of our Christmas Eve offering away to outside the church walls. If you're kind of new to WordServe, that's what we call compassion, or you might know it as missions. This tradition has allowed us to give and serve deeply within existing ministries such as Living Water International and Operation Christmas Child, but it also allowed us to give birth to entirely new ministries like Faithful Kids and Habitat for Huggins. So WordServe, through this Christmas Eve offering, has a whole history that's deep and wide of serving our community through things like Churches Left the Building or Serve Saturdays. I know many of you have participated in those. And there's so much more. It would be impossible for me to capture the last 10 years in just a few minutes. But I have looked back and put together a video over the last decade of WordServe Compassion. And one thing that, as I've done that, that is very clear to me is that we are a church that prays. We are a church that listens for God's voice, and we are a church that obeys. By his strength and provision, we are a church that has been willing to do something. We know that there continues to be some uncertainty around what 2020 will look like, but this is one thing I know for sure about this church. We'll be ready. We'll be prayerful, we'll be discerning, and we'll be ready to obey whatever is next. And the other thing I know, as I've looked back over the last 10 years, is that the next 10 years are going to be just as wild, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun, and I can't wait. So if you're kind of newer to WordServe, hopefully this video will give you kind of a glimpse of what WordServe Compassion means. And if you've been around a while, I hope you'll enjoy remembering what the Lord has done.
Morning, saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven,
Wow. You said, WordServe do all that? Yes and no. God did all that through WordServe. So thank you if you've been a part of that. If you're looking to be a part of that, I can't wait to get you connected. What we're going to do right now, though, is we're going to dismiss our kids to go with Miss Barbara and Miss Erica. And you can pick them back up at the end of service over by the gym. And while they are leaving, also just want to say thank you to Erica for making that last 10 years, most of which she's been the director of compassion, so active and so vital in our community, in our world, for that matter. So thank you, Erica, before you leave. And of course, as you all know, she loves public speaking, so ask her to come out and speak at all your events. So anyway, all right, well, will you join me in a time of prayer this morning, please? God, we thank you for all that you have done through us as we have been willing to obey. God, where we have faltered, we recognize that we are human and we confess our weakness. So pour out your Holy Spirit so that we might be stronger, that we might serve you all the more. And God, as we prepare to open your word today, I pray that you would open our hearts so that we could see as you see and we could love as you love. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it is the Christmas season, you may have noticed, I have noticed, but here's my question for you. Have you ever gotten all the way through a Christmas season and feel like you've missed the point? I do this pretty regularly. It's so busy with everything that you've got going on that you get to the end of that Christmas season and it's time to put all those things away, and you kind of remember there's a story that's supposed to be told here, and sometimes that story gets told and sometimes that story doesn't get told. Anybody in that boat with me? Yeah. So I know that a lot of times we're so busy with the things that we've got going on that we just don't have time for the story. I mean, if you think about it, there's a lot of stuff going on to make a good Christmas. Part of the things that we have to do is decorate. And I don't know if you all do this, but this is my neighbor. No, it's not my neighbor. I don't know whose that house is. It's probably the Griswold's house. But anyway, that decorating can take up so much effort and so much time, we forget that there's a story to be told behind that. I don't know if you've had this experience, but you know, when you do things like this and you put so much time and effort into it, it kind of becomes the focus, doesn't it? And if you live in the same neighborhood as this guy, it's like every time the dusk to dawn timers kick off, your appliances kind of go, and they come around. Maybe they come back up, I don't know, maybe they don't. But we get so focused on that, we get so focused on the logistics of Christmas. As I've watched the logistics of Christmas, I marvel at what people can pull together. I mean, it would put the United States military logistics to shame. I mean, you're coordinating for people to come in from out of town. You're coordinating meals. You're coordinating who's buying for whom, or maybe everybody buys for everybody if you're that kind of family. But man, I just marvel at all the stuff that goes on. But yet, is the story being told at Christmas? Sometimes I feel like we focus so much on this that we kind of miss the rest of it, this little thing that happened in a manger so long ago. And I'll admit, there's reasons that I don't focus on the story so much, because one is I've heard it so often, it's so familiar that I think just everybody knows. Well, I'm here this morning to tell you that not everybody knows. And even if they do know, it's a story worth repeating. So what I want to encourage us to do this morning is to focus on how can we keep the story alive in the midst of all this other stuff that goes on around Christmas time. How can we keep that story alive and tell it like it's the first time that we've ever heard it? Tell it like it brings us joy, because I hope that it does. So how do we do this? How do we focus on getting back to that missing story? I think we go back to the very first time that the story was told. And as we prepare to read about this first Christmas, if you're wanting to join in the Bible, we'll be at Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20 this morning. As we prepare and as you turn, let me just put the backdrop here. I mean, again, it's a familiar story, right? But understand what's happening here. We're going to focus on some shepherds out in the field, and I want you to pretend like you're a shepherd for just a moment. Now, let me explain your life. It's a life of solitude. It's a life of you being a second-class citizen, because nobody looks up to you as a shepherd. In fact, they don't really value you at all. It's what you give, it's the job that you give to the person that is the youngest in the family, or maybe the least desirable. because they're just out in the field with the sheep. And it's not a very high-paying job. It's certainly not a high-status job. It's not a job that requires a college education, and it's not a job that the famous people get. So really, you are a second-class citizen. And as they're out in the field in that evening, on Luke 2, chapter 2, verses 8 through 20, we'll read a little bit about their story. On a night like any other night, there were shepherds living in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurried off. They found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. These are the words of God. They are for the people of God, and for these words we are grateful. Think back to being that shepherd in that first century, the first time this has ever happened. You don't know this story. You don't know that angels are about to appear and give you good news and glad tidings of great joy. You have no idea that there's a heavenly concert about to break through, and yet there it is. And you don't know what they're going to ask of you. And so you're terrified. I would be too. That's what the text says. They were terrified. Because it's not natural, folks. I don't know how many of you have had this experience. You're just walking along and the heavens open up and the heavenly chorus starts singing. And they say, "Hey, good news to you." I've never had that happen. I don't know how I would react, but I'm pretty sure I would be terrified. And so they were too. But here's the thing that always fascinates me about that this whole story. The creator of the universe, sending his son to earth to assume a human form. You want to get this word out. You want this story told. This is the greatest story that's ever going to be told. Who do you say is your first messenger? CNN? Internet? YouTube? A YouTube influencer. That's who I would, because that would get the most shares and the most likes. Who's the first messenger that God picks? A shepherd. That second-class citizen that no one knows, that's out in a field all by themselves because they're with the sheep all the time, who owns no respect from the community, who's not educated, who's probably not eloquent, not theologically grounded. They didn't go to seminary. They don't know all the right words to say. Why the shepherd? Here's the greatest irony to me of all. In this scene where the angels and the chorus of heaven are talking to the shepherds, we have this representation of the very highest, except for God, and the very lowest of humanity, at least in that culture. That's how they were viewed. So from the highest to the lowest, this word is being shared. And here's what the good news is to me. This word is not just for the highest. This word is not just for the lowest. It's for everything in between. That would be you and me. I don't know how you picture yourself, what status you are, what status you are on the social ladder, how you view your self-worth. But listen, this message is for you. This good news, this glad tiding of great joy is for you, and it's for me. That's the thing that gives me the most hope in this Christmas season. That's the reason that I want to tell this story over and over ad infinitum. Is that a word? Yeah, Latin. Well, Google it. All right. So this is a story that is worth telling, and I want to tell it like it's the first time because it means that much. Now, let's go back and kind of pick through the text for just a second and figure out what is it that we can learn that will help us to tell this story. And what I would encourage us to do is to take on the mindset and the heart of a shepherd just for a moment. I always ask myself, now why would God pick a shepherd? Why would God pick these people? And the one reason I think is these people were available. These people were available to God. It's not like they had their social calendar filled. It's not like they had a lot of meetings they had to attend. They did have a flock to attend, but they would be fine. They were available to God. More importantly, God was available to them. And I think that's the point. I think that's why God chooses them over everybody else. But here are some characteristics of shepherds that I think we could adopt in this season that would help us remember to tell this story. These shepherds were humble. They were pretty simple people. Not necessarily simple-minded, but simple people. It was pretty black and white in their world. And they were fearless. Now, why is that important? It's going to be important for a couple of reasons. One is, how do you make sense of this thing that just happened? How do you rationalize this heaven open, heavenly chorus, all this stuff, and these people telling you, go over here, find this, and then go tell everybody about it? I would pick that apart. I would find a million reasons why that's not a good idea. You know, God is dark. You know, I could stumble. I could hurt myself. Yeah, there are thieves and robbers out in this area, especially this time of year with all the festivals or pickpockets in town. Or, you know, it's kind of a seedy lot. You don't really want me going out there in the dark, do you? It might be cold. I don't know what the weather's doing. I mean, what am I going to knock on every door and find out where these people are? And what do I say when I get there? It's going to be weird. It's going to be awkward. No, I'm not out for that. But these people, these shepherds, just say, okay, I'll go find them. And they did. They found them. And then they worshiped with them. And then they went and they told everybody what they had seen. Now, imagine how much... How fearless they had to be to do that. Because, you know, if you want, you think about a shepherd for just a second. They were fearless individuals. They had to defend the flock against lions, against bear, against all kinds of attacks, against people stealing sheep. I don't know. They were out there in the elements. They were tough, fearless people. But I often think that sometimes the bigger challenge isn't facing down the wild animals. I think the bigger challenge is telling the story of God. You want me to do what? Oh, I'm afraid of that. I would rather face a wild lion than I would tell my friend about this Christmas story. Because what are they going to think of me? They're going to think I'm a Jesus freak. Guilty. What are they going to, how are they going to value me after that? They're going to look at me like, oh, that poor individual that has that simplistic little faith. Aren't you more intelligent than that? Isn't that the way it always comes back? That's the most common attack I see, is an attack on our intelligence. You believe that? That's a kid's story. No, actually, it's a story about a kid who grows up to be the savior of the world. And that's the point. It's not a simple story. It's a pretty straightforward story, but it's not a simple story, not at all. I also wonder if God didn't choose the shepherd sometime because they have that bias for action. Why would God choose someone who would never share the word? Like, I'm going to have this great revelation, and I'm going to show it to Bill. And Bill's not going to do anything with it. That's not a good choice. That's not a good investment from God's part, right? Sometimes I often wonder if God doesn't look into the heart of people and go, here's a person that's actually going to take this and run. And he's not looking at their pedigree. He's not looking at their education. He's not looking at how eloquent they are, how much they love public speaking. What he's looking at is their heart and their bias for action. I think that's another thing that we can take to heart this Christmas season, having a bias for action. Action to tell this story, action to live this story. But the other thing that impresses me about the shepherds is what they didn't do, what they did not do. If you receive this message, if you were the first one to receive this and you saw this thing that was absolutely out of this world and you were the lowest of the low of status in your community, wouldn't it be tempting to say, God chose me to be the first one? You need to respect me. In fact, you owe me money for me to tell you this story. I don't know what, I probably wouldn't charge for it. But, you know, there would be an opportunity for them to lift themselves up because they were the chosen ones, the first ones that saw the encounter. They were the ones that brought the good news in human terms, the first ones. But we don't get any indication that they thought more highly of themselves. We don't get any indication that they held it over their neighbors, like, God chose me to tell this story. Got news for you. God's chosen us all to tell this story. There's no lifting up in that. There's only lifting him up in that. So it occurs to me that, the other thing that they do is they don't hide this, right? They don't just take it in and go, ooh, weird, awkward, no. Or what am I going to say? As soon as I open my mouth, it would be like, I don't want to disparage anyone, but someone who has absolutely no theological education is kind of the lowest of the low and the lowest class that we can imagine coming up to preach a sermon. You go, well, they haven't been to seminary. How are they going to know what to say? Well, here's how they know what to say. They witnessed it. They saw it firsthand. And they don't have to go to seminary to tell that story. All they have to do is say, here's what happened to me. Here's what I experienced. I experienced the God of the heaven, the heavenly chorus. I experienced, when I got into that manger, it was unworldly. I knew that that was the Savior of the world. And I want to share this news with you. I tell you, that would be a more moving sermon than anything I could come up with, certainly. It would affect you at a level that makes for transformation. Not just information, not just telling a story for information, but telling a story for transformation. A story that changes us from the inside out. A story that reflects glory to God. That's what it would do. Maybe that's why God chose them. I don't know. But it occurs to me that there is a term that I have learned, and I did not know this. I actually picked the term, or phrase rather, before I knew about this. Substance over form is what came to mind. God's more interested in substance than over form. Otherwise, why would he pick shepherds to be the first? Right? If we're looking at how things look, we're going to pick somebody who's pretty slick. We're going to pick the high priest because they know how to say it in theological terms, et cetera, et cetera. But no, God chooses substance over form. He sends his son not into a palace, not into the neonatal care unit of the best medical facility in the Middle East, into a dirty manger. Substance over form. That's what God's all about. Now, I did learn that this is actually an accounting term. How many accountants out there that are familiar with this? No? Okay, that's okay. How many accountants out there? So the idea in accounting, as I learned from the almighty Google, right, because that's where you can learn everything, is a principle that is actually done may be different from and sometimes more important than the legal or technical way that something is described. Now think about that for a minute. The way that something is described or the way that something is legally or technically told is not as important as the thing itself. What is done is more important than what we think it should look like. I'm paraphrasing badly, but this is the way that I see it. This is the story of Easter, of Christmas. Sorry, I'm thinking sermon planning, right? But here's the thing. Man, we are form-driven, are we not? It goes all the way back to the beginning of the Garden of Eden. The substance was we had a relationship with God. The substance was we had a job, we had purpose, we had meaning, we were stewards of this great garden. And the form came out from this little serpent that said, you know what you really want is a shiny apple. Look at this. There's no substance to it. It looks good though, doesn't it? Isn't it tempting? Don't you want what this has? Yes, you do. Unless we think that we're smarter than Eve or more crafty than Adam, we do the same thing today. I guarantee it. I just got a shipment in the mail for Super Greens. Anybody familiar with Super Greens? It's a powder that you mix, and it has all these plants and vegetable proteins, minerals, vitamins, all this stuff. So it's supposed to be super healthy for you. But let me ask you, will that ever replace a healthy diet? No. But here's the thing. It sure looks good, doesn't it? And the advertising plays to that. It's like, all you got to do is drink this little Super Green, and then you can eat whatever junk you want because you're eating plants. No, it doesn't work that way. You can't have one form and then ruin everything else. One thing that looks good and expect that to solve everything. But sometimes I think that's the way we act with our faith, or at least I certainly do. So we are form-based, and it goes all the way through the Bible. I mean, this is just one example. Another example that I can pull up is when the people of Israel desired a king. Well, why do you want a king? Well, because everyone else has one. Okay, well, so who do you want for the king? That guy, Saul. He looks like a king. He's tall. He's powerful. He looks like a mighty warrior. He looks like he'd be a king. Form over substance, as we find out. But then who becomes the king that builds Israel to its greatness? A little boy who is a, wait for it, shepherd. Yeah, the runt, the little one. The one that wasn't even worthy for presentation to the prophet Samuel. When Samuel went and asked Jesse, hey, can I see all your sons? He brought them all out except one because he thought, well, that's, who's going to want David? Substance or form. David doesn't look like a king. David doesn't talk like a king. David doesn't act like a king. He's just a shepherd. But God looks into the heart of people. God sees substance, not form. Folks, this is good news because we don't have to conform to the way the world wants us to be. You don't have to look a certain way. You don't have to wear a certain thing. You don't have to drive a certain thing. You don't have to live in a certain neighborhood. That's all form, folks. And I'm not criticizing if you wear nice things and live in nice places. I'm just saying that's not the main thing. The main thing is the substance underneath. And my question to us today is, what's in your substance? What are you made of? That's what God's looking at. I think that's the most important thing that we can focus on. So when it comes to form, God has some ideas of what things should look like. This is God's form. This is the culmination of this story that starts when we talk about Christmas. This is the form of a servant. This is the form that God chose to send his son into. And while we have this quaint story of a manger and a baby and the cattle, and I can just see the soundtrack playing in the background. The animals are swaying like a Disney movie, taking time with their tails, like a little metronome. Tick-tock, right? That's not what this is about. This is what that story is about. And that's why this story is about us, because he did that for us. That's why. This is the greatest story ever told, and why it's a story that needs to continue to be told. This form that God takes is found in Philippians. Paul writes about it in specifically Philippians 2, 5 through 8. Let me read that for you. It says, in your relationships with one another, have the same attitude of mind Christ Jesus had, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a human being, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's God's form. That's the form that God cares about. A form that is obedience and yet brings glory and honor, brings salvation to the world. That's substance, right? Substance over form. So how do we focus on substance over form? I think we do that in the Christmas season, especially by focusing on faith. Because the eyes of faith let us see things that we can't see with our own eyes. The eyes of faith are the ones that let us see into substance, not just how something looks. They let us see deeper than that. It lets us do three things, I think, when we focus on faith. We see differently, we share differently, and we serve differently. What do we see? When I look with the eyes of faith, I see things that only God can reveal to me. I see things that I'm not expecting to see. See, the problem that I have, that I personally have in this busyness, any busy season really, but especially this one, is I'm looking at all the lights and the glitz and all this stuff, and these are things that I'm expecting to see. And if I only look for things I expect to see, I will miss those small little things that happen. That word of encouragement that went to a cashier that's working in retail that's having a tough time. That offer of a meal to a family who's struggling. Maybe they just got laid off. These are little things, but they're not insignificant. That's my point, substance, not form. And maybe that wasn't a gourmet meal that was taken over. Maybe it was, I don't know, mac and cheese. I don't know. But what would you rather have, a gourmet meal that's or something that you know someone put their heart into because they love you? That's substance, not how it looks, how it lives. That's the secret to faith. Maybe it's time we worried less about how our faith looks and more about how our faith lives. Let me say that again. Let's worry less about how our faith looks and more about how our faith lives. What does it look like to tell this story? What does it look like to live this story? And can we do it well in a way that brings him the glory and not us? When we look with eyes of faith, we see things differently. When we look through eyes of faith, I think we share things differently. I don't know what your hesitation is in telling the story. I will tell you from my own personal past, a lot of the times when I was hesitant to talk about God is because I didn't think I knew enough. What if they ask me a question I don't have the answer to? Oh my gosh, God can't possibly defend himself, right? What if they try and catch me in a trap and I don't have an answer and I look like an idiot? I don't know if you've had these similar thoughts. These were the biggest hindrances to my sharing my faith as I was coming up. Let me tell you now, I've been to seminary, I have a master's degree, I've been a pastor, all this stuff, and guess what? I still ask myself those same questions. What if I look like an idiot? Somebody asks me a question I don't know. Now the pressure's on. I should know. I've been to seminary. I should know everything. Let me tell you, that's not what seminary is about. If you're interested, let me know. All right. I still don't know everything, but here's what I've come to know, is that my willingness to tell the story that I know, the story that I have experienced, cannot be argued with. You can't tell me that that didn't happen. No, this is how God worked in my life. This is how I've seen God move. This is what God is teaching me right now. And if I can back it up in this book, I will tell that story. If I can't back it up in this book, I'll continue to research. And if I can't ever back it up in this book, I'll let that go. But you know what I'm finding is that the more that I surrender myself to God and the more that I see him working in my life, the more I can back it up in this book. And if I'm worried that they're going to ask a question that I don't know the answer to, pretty sure God's big enough to answer that question. And I've learned to say, it's okay to say, I don't know. Yeah, that's a good one. I don't know. And one of the best relationships that I've had was a guy. This guy was in Kentucky, kind of a rough character, the guy that walks in the church and all the heads go hair down to here, tattoos all up and down, a really rough looking character. It obviously had been ridden hard and put up wet, if you know. Yeah, hard life, you could tell just by looking. And he asked me a question, and I was on staff at a church in Nicholasville, Kentucky, and guess what? I didn't know. I didn't know the answer. And so this was the first time in my journey when I began to adopt this idea that it's okay not to know and it's okay to say, I don't know. I said, man, I don't know, but you know what? If you will come back and you and I just meet for a few weeks, let's check it out together in here and let's see if we can find an answer. And so, by the way, I don't know that I ever really answered his question, but the cool thing was after about 3 weeks, I didn't have to ask him to come back anymore. He just kept coming back. And when I left Kentucky, he was still going to church. He was still in a men's group, still in a Bible study men's group. And that man could work. That dude was strong. He had carpentry skills, as we learned later. And as I reflected on it, I was like, of course he had carpentry skills. Of course he had hair down to here. Of course he didn't look like he fit in. He was Jesus walking into my life, right? That's how it works. We're so focused on hitting that home run every time. I've got to have the perfect answer. I've got to have the perfect sermon. I've got to have the perfect whatever, the perfect answer to any question. And no, you don't. All we have to do is just advance the runners. All we have to do is step into the batter's box and be willing to swing. Are you going to hit every ball? No. Are you going to strike out occasionally? Sure, I have. I'm probably the king of strikeouts. But guess what? In baseball, there are these things called innings. And just because you struck out once doesn't mean you're one and done. There's another chance coming. What can you learn from the last time where you struck out that will make it better for the next time? This is a God of second chances and a God of hope. This is why this is a story that deserves to be told. So if we are open with our eyes to see things that we don't expect, see things that God's at work, maybe little things, but not insignificant things, then we can share that. That's a good place to start. And when we share that story, it shapes how we serve. I can't not serve having seen the life of Jesus. If we're Jesus followers, if we intend to actually follow this Jesus, if we know his story, not just from a factual point, but if we know beyond the form, what's the substance of Jesus' story? I don't think we can't not serve. Is that right? I can't not serve. I got to do something. That's what I'm trying to say. We got to do something. Now, maybe I'm not going to change the world. Maybe I'm not going to do some huge project that gets worldwide attention. But as we have just said, It's the little things that God can use to make great things. Don't let the seemingly insignificance of what you're contemplating doing stop you from doing it. Do it anyway and give it to God and watch what he does with it. It'll be amazing, I guarantee it. It'll probably floor you. So we see differently, we share differently, and we serve differently because in the service we understand that we're not actually working for people. I know that sounds backwards from what you're thinking. I'm not actually working for the people I serve. I'm working for God to serve his people. There's a difference. In a nutshell, it's the difference between, you know, some of the objections to serving, well, we're just enabling them. Oh, we're just making them dependent on us. Well, yeah, if I do everything that they want and I become in that relationship an enabler for them, then maybe I haven't really done them any good. But if I'm serving God and serving people, working for God and serving people, then I will do things that will better their circumstances. They won't depend on me. They'll depend on God if I do it right. My whole goal in life is not to go, come to me, I have all the answers. My whole goal is to go to him. He's got all the answers. And make that connection. That's the connection, and that's the way that I want to serve going forward. Never about us. Maybe that's where it starts, but never ends there. It changes how we see. It changes how we share. It changes how we serve. There we go. So, as we go into this Christmas season, I just want to remind us that there's a story that's worth telling. And whether that's the story that you can eloquently portray just like out of the Bible, that's great. If that's a skill for you, awesome. You do that. But you know what? The story that you live is going to be far greater than the story that you tell. The way that our faith looks is not near as important as the way that our faith lives. That's the encouragement that I want to give you today. No matter where you are in this, the Holy Spirit will guide us through this. Our faith doesn't just look good, it lives good. And maybe this is the year that we don't wait for that perfect form or that perfect moment. We don't have to have that perfect lighting. We don't have to have the perfect wrapping. We don't even have to have the perfect meal. Is that sacrilege? Yeah. What we have to have is substance over form. What the world needs is for us to tell his story, not our story. So maybe this is the lesson that we can take into Christmas this year as we strive to live a faith that tells the story well. Let's focus on the faith, and the story will tell itself through you. Will you pray with me, please? God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the one who came down in this Christmas season. But we thank you more for the story that continues to be told, and we thank you that you invite us to be a part of that story. God, I pray for eyes today that will see like you see, so that we can see those little things, not insignificant, but maybe small, that would have gone unnoticed during this time of year. Help us to see where you're at work. Bolster our faith. Help our witness so that as we see you work, we can describe you to others and thus tell your story. And help us to share that story because it's the one that will make the difference, the one that will transform us. And then God, help us to serve out of that story. So the story that tells of selfless love and sacrifice, of giving to others, but not blindly, giving in service to God as we serve his people. God, remind us of all this as we go forward in this Christmas season. Renew our faith, renew our sight, renew our hearts so that we can love like you do. And as we focus on the faith, the things that we can't see, help the story to tell itself through us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
innocence. With openness,
someone who has surrendered, when I think of someone who lets their faith tell the story, I think of Norm and Mary. And Norm and Mary are in the back, and this is their last Sunday with us as they are getting ready to move. And so I normally would invite them up to share, but with COVID and all, we're going to say they're right back there. Wave, everybody. Hey. Norm and Mary have been an integral part of WordServe when it comes to serving. Norm has been out there on the forefront when it comes to seeing and sharing. Mary has made a significant impact. Now, the good news is she can continue and they can continue to do all that virtually, right? So they're with the women's group. I hope you'll continue to season that group with your knowledge and your wisdom. And Norm, I know you're going to serve wherever you end up because that's just who you are. But I want to thank you both for what you have contributed to WordServe and what you have, the difference that you have made in our telling our story. So thank you very much for your faithfulness and your dedication. Absolutely. That, and if I invited him up, Norm would probably punch me because he just doesn't want to be up in front of people. But hey, we appreciate it. I don't want to bob and weave in front of the congregation, right? So as we get ready to go forward, hear this. It's not what our faith looks like. It's how our faith lives that makes a difference. So go and let God tell the story through you as you look through eyes of faith and see things that you would never see. Tell a story that's been told, but tell it your way to his glory. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.